So these two are very quite significant from one another. They are both searchlight signals, but they are made by two separate manufacturers. What is better? Let's find out. But before this video starts, I'm only going to be discussing about the GRS-SA series searchlight signals and the US&S H2 searchlight signals because they are the most common ones to be found in active service today. But also, within 5 to 10 years from now, searchlight signals will now be replaced all by PTC signals from this year, and we are losing one of the most iconic railroad signals that have ever been mass-produced during the steam and today's era. During the year of the 1860s, Thomas Hall, owner of the Hall Signal Company, first patented the very first type of searchlight signal called the disc signal. It was first patented in 1867 and they started mass producing them in 1869. Until 1925, the Hall Signal Company was purchased by the Union Switch and Signal Company. But getting to the point about the disc signal, which then earned the nickname banjo because of its very characteristic and very unique design. Nearly 1,500 of these banjo signals have been produced until they lasted into the service until 1869, but very few had remained in service on railroads until the 1940s. And here are some very rare colored pictures of the banjo signals in active service until when they were replaced by searchlight signals. Vaguely that they were US&S searchlight signals, as you can see in this photograph as well during their replacement. Let's start things off with the Union Switch and Signal searchlight signals. The US&S production of the US&S searchlight signals have been easily recognized by rail fans and enthusiasts. Union Switch and Signal have multiple series of the H series searchlight signals from the H2. There are also H3s and H4s that were pretty much the same concept and the design of the H2. I don't know what the difference is between them, but if you know, let me know in the comments below. And the last series was the H5, which was very few had been produced, but mostly that they were on the Santa Fe from what I can see. From then, there were some that were still active until of last year, or there are some that are still active to this day. Still, a good percentage of H2 searchlight signals are still in service to this day, but what I mentioned in the beginning of this video, and I may mention it throughout this video, that from 5 to 10 years from now, searchlight signals will be replaced by positive train control signals, PTC. So, very little by little, these signals are slowly disappearing from service because who would not love a searchlight signal because of its very unique design? For some people may not know that what does the H mean in H2 or H series of searchlight signals? The H meant that it was in honor of Thomas Hall, who was the inventor of the searchlight signal, who again was bought out by Union Switch and Signal himself. And still throughout, H2 and the H-series searchlight signals have lasted for many, many years, from during the 1930s or earlier than that, up until they continued and discontinued production of the searchlight signals in the 1980s. But we'll get to that for what we're going to look at next. Now what we have here is a SA-series searchlight signal that was produced by the General Railway Signal, or GRS, company. Their production of the GRS SA-series searchlight signal was in production from 1927 to the 1980s. Today, interestingly, there is a less percentage of SA series searchlight signals than the US&S searchlight signals. They've become more popular than the US&S H series searchlight signals, but have gained more value than the US&S searchlight signals. Why is that? Well, there's multiple questions that will now be answered. Let's start out with size comparison. Well, first thing that to explain about for the H2 searchlight signal, for the size first. The length of it with the hood that's on it currently right now is 32.5 inches. Without the hood, it's 17.5 inches. With something that I call the dwarf hood is basically half the size of the hood that's currently on my searchlight signal. And here's an example of one that is at Rondout on a siding track. The width of an H2 searchlight signal is 9.5 inches, and the height as it is right now is 22 inches with the dwarf mounting plate that could be additional to it. Again, here's the example of a dwarf signal from a US&S searchlight signal that would obviously increase its height to 25 inches, maybe 23, I don't know. Maybe it would be the same height as it is set right now. The SA searchlight signal is a little bit different. The length, 27.5 inches. The width is exactly 9 inches. And the height is as it is right now because I cannot mount it with the mounting plate that's on it to mount it on a mounting arm for a pole. As it is right now, it's 18.5 inches tall. Feature-wise, GRS had multiple features and accessories available for the GRS and the US&S searchlight signal. For example, lenses. The one that my GRS searchlight signal has is what's called a stepped lens, as in that it has little ridges inside of it that is like a step to make the curved lens on it. While it also is available for the GRS searchlight signals, on my US&S searchlight signal, it has a thick glass lens, and that is also available for the GRS searchlight signals. But the glass ones mean that obviously that it's for the age, that if it has a glass lens, that it was probably made in the previous earlier periods. Also accessory-wise, that the GRS searchlight signal has multiple targets available for it for identifying railroads. Well, we have the most common one, which is the circular or the disc target that's on the back of it. There's also the smaller version, which is common on the New York Central. And here's an example of what it looks like. And also, which is also have becoming a very iconic searchlight signal, is the beanhead. And the beanhead is a common searchlight signal design target that is used on the Chicago and Northwestern. And the ones that are still around to this day are along the Union Pacific's Geneva sub on the X Northwestern. There used to be ones that were at Rochelle, and here's some examples of ones that were in service at Rochelle before they were removed from service. Other than that, the US&S searchlight signal that it only had for me, that what I remember is that it only has the circular target, or without the target as a dwarf. That could also, GRS searchlight signals can be found as dwarfs as well. But also, one thing to mention, that a double stacked dwarf signal for both of these searchlight signals are quite rare today. I have an example here of one that's in Milwaukee, and that one is a US&S H2 double mounted dwarf signal. To me, the US&S searchlight signals are a little bit more bulkier in their design, while compared to the GRS searchlight signals, they're quite smaller. But the US&S searchlight signals were obviously built much tougher. That's why there's a lot of them still in active service to this day, because of the way that they're designed. The SA searchlight signals, due to their small size, it uses less metal and less material, so they were much lighter, making them easier to install, maintain, and in case if one is broken, they're easily replaceable. Because of their value, they were easy and they were cheap to make, but they were also very, very well made in design. Internally wise, there's also a big difference with the mechanisms that were used for GRS and US&S searchlight signals. Now here are, on the left is a SA internal mechanism and a H2 internal mechanism for my searchlight signals. Of course, they are both made by separate manufacturers, but there's big differences between them. Obviously, the internal inner workings that are inside the mechanism, and the way that the beam is passed through the reflector screens that give off from the reflector unit that's in the back of these units. The size is also a difference between the mechanisms as well. The SA searchlight mechanism is 27.5 inches long. It's 9 inches wide. Also 18.5 inches in height. The H2 internal mechanism lengthwise is 11.25 inches long, 7.25 inches wide, and 7.25 inches tall. So, The H2 internal mechanism is just slightly smaller than the SA searchlight mechanism, but the SA searchlight signal packs a punch when it comes to the passing beam light that goes through the parabolic lens. Here is the second SA series searchlight signal mechanism that I have that shows what the lens passes through after when the light passes through the lens. It passes through this cone that's inside of here that has these ridges inside of here. I don't know what the purpose of the ridges were, but I believe that it was used to make the beam brighter because the screen is just right up inside of here. And then it passes through here, creating the really powerful beam. And with the parabolic glass lens that's on the other one that I have, it makes the beam even brighter. Compared with the US&S one, the light passes through the lens and there's no cone. Well, basically there is, but I wouldn't call it a cone. I would call it just a cup that it will just pass through, and the beam doesn't look as bright as what some people think, unless if you're staring right into it. I mean, at any angle, you could see on the GRS searchlight mechanisms, at any angle, you could easily see the beam. Now, here's the back of both of my searchlight signal mechanisms. This is the GRS, and this is the US&S one. There's a big difference between both of them that I call this like hookup connectors that are back here. This is the SA searchlight GRS mechanism. It sticks out here, and the US&S one, it's buried underneath. Both of them have diagrams on both of them to show how they're hooked up together. The light bulb sources, and what I would say, it's like a parabolic lens that's back here. They're both the same, that you have to twist them to open them up. With the US&S mechanism, you have to turn counterclockwise and unlock it from the pins to open it up. And then you turn it clockwise to lock it into place. With the GRS mechanism, you have to turn it clockwise to unlock it and then pull the lens out. And then you turn it counterclockwise to lock it into place. Also, the resistors are a little bit different. This one, you unscrew to manually adjust the resistance on the bulb. On the GRS one, it's just the nut that holds it on there, so you have to use our wrenches and tools, where you can just use your fingers on this. So the resistors are quite simple to use, so are the ones to open it up. Also, there's also a big difference with these, the hookup connectors that are here, which I'll explain later. And also, one other thing that's a little bit different is the way that these internal mechanisms lock and install into the housings of my searchlight signals, but I'll get to that later. We'll first start off by installing the H2 internal mechanism into my H2 housing. First things off is to, if you have a lock on it, you take the lock off. And you unscrew the handle, you unscrew it 5 times, and then you lift up on the handle with the spring plate that's inside the door that keeps the hook that clamps onto the latch that's on the inside of the mechanism. A very common and very interesting design for the way that the door locks into place, and it's kind of cool. You carefully slide the mechanism inside the housing. You have to make sure that you line up the 2 holes that are on the side of the mechanism for the bolts and the little pin that slides into this little pinhole on the top of the mechanism. Be careful not to make sure that you don't pinch your fingers while installing the mechanism into there. Carefully have your hand resting on the bottom of the mechanism if they're thin enough, and carefully slide the mechanism into the pinhole. Make sure that you have a guess of where the hole is, so when you slide the pin into it, you'll know when it slides in, and then it will just hang and dangle. After installing the mechanism inside the housing, making sure that the pin goes into the hole, and once it's dangling, you're ready to install the bolts inside of it. The bolts have half-inch heads, and you use a half-inch socket hand screwdriver that I have here, that once you first slowly hand feel the threads when they lock into place. Because it is quite tricky to install these bolts in these little holes that you could hardly see. They're a little bit difficult to line up. But once you find that sweet spot, they'll slide right in, they'll slip into their threads. And then you use the hand threaded socket, which is again a half inch socket that I have here. And then you, little by little, you tighten them down, but not too tight. Once they're ready and nice and snug, you're all set and you're all finished up. Now we can install and hook up our wire connections. The first thing that you got to make sure is that where you got to connect your wires. The directional source for the interchangeable moving lens that's inside of it, with the where it changes the color of the signal, it's the two little screw bolts that are in the middle of the mechanism. Make sure that you check the diagram that's on the side of the mechanism here that shows where the connections are for the magnetic coil for the moving screens. Again, they are half-inch nuts with a half-inch socket, and you put your negative to the left and positive on the right. I'm using red and black wires for this process. The process also works for the bulb as well, and they're the ones that are on the outer edge of the mechanism. One thing to keep in mind is that the ones that are not in use, which is in the sections, the three that are not in use, for example, the ones that have the cut wires on them, those ones are for the repeaters. I'm not sure how the repeaters work, but I think it's the way that they are used as relays, that they're obviously connected for some of the relays that are in signal boxes that are along the line by the signals that connect to other signals within blocks. Then you could just close up the door, lock it into place, lift up on the handles so the hook latches on the clip that's inside of it, rotate the handle 5 times, and then it's all sealed up. If you have a lock, you just lock it up. Installing a SA internal mechanism into a GRS searchlight housing, the concept is pretty much the same, but the threads on the hinge handle that locks onto the latch inside, it's quite similar, but a little bit fewer rotations and it easily opens up, carefully setting the door down. But instead of pinholes and bolts that hold these internal mechanisms in here, there's a big difference. Like I showed the inner housings of both my H-series and SA-series searchlight signals, that they're both different in design when installing an internal mechanism. Like I said, about instead of installing using bolts and a pinhole, the SA searchlight signals, their housings use holes, pins, locking pins, locking cams, and a track. A lot of words to use, but it made them installing them easier. Why is that? I'll show you right now. Now we have my SA internal mechanism all ready to go, but notice that the connectors that are on the back of it are missing. They're inside of my housing. The wires are already connected to them. You take your internal mechanism and make sure that you install the hanger onto the track. And the track is in the top of the internal mechanism where it's like a guide. It easily sets up there, and it's adjustable to the height so you can line up the pins to the holes. As you just saw, that installing the internal unit is quite easier than you doing the H2 internal mechanism. And you also might notice again that what it's called is a plug coupler, where the connectors are for the wiring. The plug coupler is designed for it to be removed, so installing a SA searchlight mechanism is easier to maintain and replace if one attempts to fail, if the coils go bad, that all the maintainer has to do is to pull the plug off without disconnecting any wires, pull out the mechanism, and install a new mechanism in literally half the time it takes to install an US&S internal mechanism. When installing the internal mechanism, you first push the internal guts. It's what some other people sometimes call them. You push them through the track, and then you'll notice that the locking cams will start to lift up. On some of them, other than this one, they lock up into place to clear the pins. Once the internal mechanism passes the pins on this one, you'll see that the locking cams will lift up. And once that they're past the locking pins, they'll start to drop, and then you just push them the rest of the way to lock them into place. Now we can install the plug coupler. Make sure that the little metal pins that are right here are out of locking into place. Basically, that these will hold the plug coupler into place. And same concept that the connectors to the bulb is pretty much the same. There's the diagram that shows how to install them and where the coil is. And in case if you're wondering which one the coil is to the screen that moves in front of the light, it's these two right here. What this is right here is a ground, and it's usually installed into the plug coupler here, but this one doesn't have a ground arrestor, or what they call it is a air gap lightning arrestor. But again, it's not here. So what you do is you move these past this. You line up the holes with the copper connectors that are here, and you just push it into place. You could whack it into place, and they'll lock into place. Lift up the pins, and they'll slide right down. And that's how you install an SA internal mechanism into a GRS searchlight. So after installing the mechanism, you, whatever wires that you have dangling out, you stuff inside the mechanism and close it right up. Same process as the US&S searchlight. Rotate, close it up, put a lock, whatever you like have on there, and you're all set. Now that both mechanisms have been installed into both searchlight signals, now let's power them on and let's experience of how searchlight signals were operative on the railroad. So another big question of why the searchlight signals were invented. The searchlight signals were made so then it will cost less than using a 3-bulb signal, for example, the ones that we have today, which is for PTC, that it uses the mechanical lenses and the magnetic coils and screens that are used inside of it. So of one light source with a parabolic lens, it uses it to make a very powerful light source. So it uses less energy and less parts to make these signals. So they made them very, very special for the railroads these days. It was very cost efficient, and when they were using low volts, as I mean they were using about 10 volts or less to make these very powerful light sources, that it was very great on a lot of railroads. It was, again, it was cost efficient, and it became very famous, and searchlight signals were almost everywhere on the railroad. And they brought a lot of fame to their design, and it earned a lot of hearts from rail fans. So let's start with the H2 searchlight signal. But if you have been following my YouTube channel for the past many years, you'll probably remember that this one is the one that I have restored over the years. As of a couple years ago that I've finished completing it, it has the prism inside of it. Prisms are also available for searchlight signals, but I'll explain other accessories later in this video. Now we'll look at the operation of the SA searchlight signal. So the comparison between both internal mechanisms, maybe you've seen it. But I'll show you again. I'll first explain about that the way that the mechanisms activate once a circuit picks up for when a train is approaching in the block, as in like what kind of signal that it has. Pretend the dispatcher is giving the train that is approaching this signal a highball or a green. You notice something, that both mechanisms did go to green. But if you noticed, I'll play the video again in slow motion here, that when the green aspect has been charged or has been applied to the coil, you'll notice that the US&S screen bounces a little bit. Other than the GRS mechanism, it just stays in place with a little bit of a bounce. But with the parabolic lens and the small spacing with the cone that's inside of it that gives off the powerful beam, that the bouncing lens is barely visible. Now we'll drop them from green to red. The engine and the train knocks the signal down. There's a little delay with the GRS mechanism, and the US&S one immediately drops to red. But that doesn't really matter. Now the train enters the next block, where the signal back then gives an approach. Again, you notice that the lens on the US&S mechanism bounces, and you could just see it just slightly. And on the ESA one, it's barely noticeable, or not noticeable at all. I just really love it when you hear that nice mechanical noises that the mechanisms make when it hits that stopper inside of the housing of the mechanism, which, if you're out rail fanning, you could probably hear that when the train passes the signal. I wouldn't say pass the signal, but when the train enters the next block, or when the dispatcher gives the signal to that signal in that area for the next train. Remember when I said about the term for staring into fire is what engineers give? Here's an example of what I mean. Because of a slanted red screen, it looks like that you're staring into fire. That's why the camera immediately adjusted to the light that it's giving off from the lens that's inside of it. And that parabolic lens gives it a really great source, because you can see this signal from many miles away. Now I'll show you how easy and quick it is to swap an internal mechanism off of a GRS searchlight signal and a US&S signal, and both of them will be timed, and I'll show to you why it was quicker and easier for a GRS mech to be replaced compared to the US&S H2. Now I'll demonstrate of how long it takes to replace a US&S internal mechanism. I don't have a second one, so this will be just a demonstration of how long it takes to replace just an H2 mechanism of just the one that I have for now, but I'll pretend that I'll have a second one on hand. Well, this concludes everything that I have put together from these two Searchlight signals that I have. From the amount of days that I spent putting this video together, with all the gathered information that I have received, questions that I had answered from, and everything that I had to do just to make this video possible. So I just wanted to thank anybody who is watching this video, who helped me out with this. And with so much gratitude that I have received from, and also the kind and helpfulness from other people, anybody who's watching this video, I appreciate you taking your time to watch this video altogether. So, as always, thanks for watching, and if you have any questions, I'd be happy to answer them. And also, comment below, what is your favorite Searchlight signal that I have here? You're either the SA, GRS, or the US&S H2. If you have any else, I'd be happy to answer your questions. So, take care. I'll see you next time on the next video.